Do you want to go this way?
Yeah.
Go?
Yes.
Great.
Whatever works.
So first I want to say that I don't feel I'm in the industry yet, especially I compared to all the people here. But I started working after my undergrad. I wrote this feature that I had no idea that I, you know, how to write features, but I wrote a feature. And I presented it to this contest and it won. And I went there and I picked up, and so I started meeting like producers and everything. So then I started getting some work as a screenwriter in Spain. I had no idea what I was doing. And that's why later I came to Colombia to be like, okay, I feel like a fake. I feel like I don't know what it is that I'm doing. So I wanna understand how to be a screenwriter, and I wanna have the tools. But during that time, I co-wrote a feature that's 10,000 kilometers. That's a film that won South by Southwest and it premiered this year in U.S. theaters. And through that, it's very strange because you usually write a feature and then like 3 years later it premieres, and like a long time, a really long time later. And through that, now I'm getting more work, I guess, and I'm starting to work as a screenwriter more. And then I transitioned into writing and directing this film that went to a few festivals this year in Toronto and Telluride. And this has been my experience so far. I feel like maybe where I'm at right now can be helpful for you guys, because I'm just beginning and I'm, you know, trying to face some of the problems that probably all of you will be facing in like 1 or 2 years. So I guess that's how I can be helpful for you. So like, any questions that you have?
I feel similarly about, I don't feel like I'm in any industry at any, maybe I will never feel like that. But I graduated in May actually from the directing program, and in October-ish won a contest and made a feature film, and now I'm just making another film now. And I had made a lot of shorts. I'd gone to an undergraduate university, Loyola Marymount, for film production, and made shorts there, and worked as a cinematographer, worked as a writer, you know, made projects kind of all over the place, made films in Nigeria and Italy and Greece and South Africa, just, you know, kept making shorts, and some of them went to film festivals, and yeah, that's it.
So I guess I was initially interested in working more in like the business side of independent film, and I worked at a management company and a finance company, and kind of felt like I was jealous of the people who were actually making the films, and so I produced a little documentary with a friend, and then I started working with my dad, who was kind of a Hollywood producer in his career and was getting kind of frustrated with how difficult it is to get anything made in the studio system. And having spent a couple years in the really low budget world, he and I started working together and produced 3 independent movies that have come out in the last couple years. And over the course of producing those movies, I always liked the post-production element of it the most. And so I'm currently working as an assistant editor, and I want to write and direct, and so I guess I've done kind of tried to do the opposite of these guys, which I kind of get some sort of a thing going where I'm like making money as working in the movie business and hope that when I'm actually trying to write, you know, I'm now writing, going to try to direct something in the spring, that might help. But, you know, it's cool because I'm working right now with a director I really like, and so I'm kind of trying to learn things that way.
Great. Well, I kind of answered the question, but I'll get a little deeper. So when I was in college, I really had no idea of what I wanted to do. I was political science, which meant really nothing. I wasn't going to become a politician or anything. But I loved it here, and I played on the club lacrosse team. And I was going up to what I thought was a lacrosse meeting, and this was in the old Ferris Booth building. I don't even know if that's called, and some of these buildings don't have names anymore, like this one. So I went to go up to the meeting, and I took a wrong turn, and I walked into WKCR-FM, and I saw a guy behind a microphone broadcasting the news, and I saw all of the equipment, and I was like, oh my God, this is so cool. I totally forgot about the lacrosse meeting, although I went on and played and had a great time playing, still friends with some of those guys today. But I was like, I want to get into this. I don't know what it is, but I want to do this. And I took, you know, I signed up, and I took my FCC Class 3 license, which was a broadcasting license, so that you could, you know, actually be on air and have some modicum of responsibility, and learn how to like fade up and fade down and run a PSA and whatnot. And I started doing the news, and I was just so into it. And you know, but I again never knew that that was anything I even was interested in. And then I got an internship at ABC News through a friend, and you know, I was like, you know, I was actually pledging a fraternity here in college, and I was also like pledging there. I was like, you know, running scripts, getting coffee for the anchors. I just would do anything to be part of the excitement of news. And this was during the Persian Gulf War I. Kind of dates me, and it was just so exciting. And I just, you know, my whole career in the news business was like, what's next? I went to CNN, where it was one of the greatest experiences back then. It was a true meritocracy where you had to take like a newsmaker test. So I started in like the bottom again, and they give you like this fancy title, video journalist. But really, what it meant was like, we'll pay you like 16 grand, and you know, you'll run the camera, you do the teleprompter, you do anything. But you took these tests, the newsmaker tests, where you had to know. They'd ask you questions like, you know, who are some of the Supreme Court justices, and what's the capital of Indonesia, and you know, tell me some cabinet members. And you just kind of, I kind of, you know, moved up that way, and then went to Fox News Channel. All right, I know I should probably get out of here now, but this was in the beginning of Fox, and I had this awesome experience. They were sending me all over the place as a field producer, working in you know, a live TV truck and a satellite truck. And and believe it or not, I a friend of mine asked me, you know, do you want to go to a boxing show? And I was like, boxing? I hate boxing. You know, I grew up in the city. I was just, you know, completely not my sport. But I said yes, and I went to this boxing show, and it was up in the Bronx in this little field house. And it was like, if there was ever a Hollywood scene of a boxing show, this was it. It was, you know, smoke-filled field house with bringing in one guy, then the next. The gladiatorial nature of it was just like, wow, this was such a different world than I'd ever been exposed to. And again, I was like, I just want to do this. I want to be involved. So I went to a promoter, and I said, listen, I'd like to work for you. And you know, he said, okay, you could do public relations. So I was like, all right. And little did I know that public relations meant driving a van, picking the guys up from the airport, bringing them to the motel in Yonkers, then bringing them, you know, for medicals and whatnot. And again, I was on the bottom of the rung. And you know, you could just imagine my parents. They had paid for college. You know, I had been in the news business. I'd made it to producer, and here I was, like, who knows, doing what? But again, I had that hunger and that desire to excel. And you know, I slowly became a manager and an agent of a lot of fighters, and traveled all over the place. And while I was in this world, I was in a gym in the Bronx. I'll try to wrap it up. I don't want to take too much time. but I was in a gym in the Bronx, and there was a guy that was living in the basement of this gym, and his name was Louis Resto. And Louis Resto had this story. Everyone was like, that was Louis Resto. He was banned from the sport of boxing. He went to jail, you know, but he was the nicest guy. So anyway, I found his story. It was a story of, you know, the fact that, you know, he was fighting a guy named Billy Collins Jr. in 1983 at Madison Square Garden on the undercard of Roberto Duran and Davey Moore. And he was, you know, kind of a medium fighter, wasn't really like a special fighter, but Billy Collins was like the fighter that, you know, all promoters want, undefeated, good looking. And but by the end of the night, Louis Resto had won, and Billy Collins' face looked like he had elephantitis. And Resto went over to his corner, and to shake, you know, the hand of the loser, and his father, Billy Collins Sr., a former fighter himself, grabbed the glove, said, "There's no padding in these gloves. There's no padding in these gloves." And what ensued after that was a terrible tragedy. Collins would never fight again. Some say because of his permanent eye damage, some say because of alcoholism, some say because of suicide. He drove his car off a cliff less than 8 months later. Resto and his trainer were found guilty of tampering with the gloves. They were sent to jail, and they were banned from the sport of boxing forever. So when I met Louis, he was, you know, was 25 years later, living in the basement of this gym, and he was proclaiming his innocence. So I went to a friend of mine. I said, "Hey, let's make a movie." You know, my journalistic instincts picked up. We pooled together a little money, and we made this documentary about Louis Resto, because I had access to Louis. So and he was saying he was innocent. I'll wrap it up really quickly, but what happened was, halfway through the movie, we uncovered some information from one of the court hearings where there was an undercover cop who had had a Negra, a wiretap. And while he was jogging Resto, the undercover cop interviewed him, and Resto admitted to some things. But that was suppressed during the trial. Well, anyway, I uncovered that information and then was really upset because I had spent about all of the money that we had pooled together to make this documentary. And this guy was lying to me. You know, this documentary was about, you know, setting this guy free. So I took the transcripts and I took my camera and my cameraman, and I went in and confronted Resto, and I said, "Look, you said this," and he admitted it. And what happened after that was the movie. You know, I didn't know what to do, so I took him on a redemption trip. And he went and he apologized to Collins, his father. He admitted to his own sons that he had been lying to for 25 years, and the film worked out. You know, we got a lot of praise. We won an Emmy for this one, and then I started making films after that, because one of the publicists at HBO said, "You know, well, what are you doing next?" And I said, "What do you mean, what am I doing next?" He goes, "That's the first question people are going to ask you, is what is your next film?" And that's how I got into filmmaking. Sorry it took so long.
For me, it was just mostly writing and it was just writing. I was fortunate enough to go to an experimental high school that had a repertory company, so I got to see plays for the first time in my senior year, and then I decided to read every play I could get my hands on, and I ended up at school on a math, really studying math, but somehow I just couldn't stop writing, and won some playwriting awards, and when I got out, essentially, I was lucky enough to go to NYU when there was a dramatic writing going on, and it was really kind of a great moment there, because they turned you on to television writing and screenwriting, so I got to experiment in all those forms, and some people, really great teachers, sort of stepped up and kind of guided me through. One was like Lorenzo Semple, and Tina Howe, and I mean, there were just some really great people there at the moment, and there was some other really great students at the same time there. There was like Neela Butte and Kenny Lonergan, and there was like a little clique happening, and we all kind of wanted to play with the forms and not just stick to playwriting. And for me, like at the same time I was doing plays and running a theater company, I was writing screenplays all the time. So I just kept writing whatever I could. I just wanted to write in a form where people, I could put words in people's mouths. And then an opportunity showed up, and I was pretty young at the time, but somebody was like, "You want to write for television?" And it was the show Homicide. And a lot of my other friends, people I'd gone to school with, didn't want to do TV at the moment. They were kind of like, it's the lower thing. And I was like, I don't know, man. I'm going to write, you know, people are going to say it, and it's going to be on a screen. So I jumped, I jumped on it. And it was kind of a great, it was very opportune, because from that moment on, I've been kind of working mostly in television, a little bit in film, and a bit in theater. And a lot of those people at the moment back then who didn't want to jump on it have also kind of come around and wanted to be part of it in the last few years. So that's kind of how I got into it. It was just watching this play this repertory company did and just started writing. But at every moment I wanted it, if there was an opportunity to have somebody say lines of dialogue, I kind of jumped on it. I didn't care if it's the web. I don't care if it was a 99-seat house with no lights. I don't care if it was helping out somebody on a super low budget. It was being made like on an iPhone. I don't care. Like, I just want to just write and have people say it.
Thank you. Okay, so one of my favorite questions, but what are some of like the unspoken rules of the industry that, you know, whether it has to do with behavior or, like Eric, you said, they always want to know what you have next, you know? What are some of the things that people don't realize when they're first going in? And like, what did you wish you knew, like, when you first started working in the industry?
As I said before, I'm just starting, so I am discovering the rules. But one of the things that I always realize is that people keep telling you there are all these rules, and then you go in and there aren't really that many rules. Like, you basically like make, yeah, for me, like, so far, it has always been like making up as I go, you know? It's like, oh, I have this script that I really, really want to write because it's a story that, I think one of the things that I have been asked a lot, and I think it's a very interesting question, is why do you want to do this? And, you know, why you and nobody, why do you have to tell this story? And I think it's a very important question, at least I think I'm trying to apply it to things that I do, because I think it's very valuable to, like, why is this your story? Why do you want to tell this? Why is this important? Why do you think people want to watch this? And then I think the rest of the all these rules, like, I'm just getting started with the world of agents and managers and all these, and it sounds like a very, very complicated thing, but I think that for me, the only thing that is important is actually, like, you know, no, being honest about the work that you want to do, because otherwise, why do you want to do it anyways? Like, I always think that if we're into this because we really like it, right? Because it's not because of the money, probably, you know, at least not at the beginning, because if we were in law school, we would make much more money than being here, or not, I don't know. But it's like, you know, just being very honest about what you do and why you want to do it. And then I guess just like working really hard and trusting, like, I think everybody who works in film and who writes is like people who work really hard, who's like actually working in the industry. Like, it's people who are working all the time and who are developing new things. And this thing is like, what are you gonna do next? Also a thing that you get asked. So you have to be all the time like, but it's not like you have to do it. It's just like, if you like film so much, or you like to tell stories so much, you're gonna have another story that you want to tell. It's just a thing that I guess should happen naturally. You shouldn't be like, oh, I mean, I really need to find something that these people are going to like, because I think that's the wrong approach to the whole thing. It's not what are they going to like, it's what do you want to say, because that's going to be, and if they like it, great. If not, like, I always think that if there's not a door open, you gotta make your own door, right? So like, you're gonna find a way to do it, hopefully. But again, I'm just getting started, so maybe there are a bunch of rules that I should know about.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that. I maybe have a strange perspective on the industry, but I kind of come at it as a fan of films, and there are a lot of rules about storytelling and things like that that people will kind of throw at you and assume that you must follow these things. And when you look at the films that you love, I usually find that the ones that I'm particularly drawn to are not really in some kind of formula. And that kind of disseminates out to many aspects of the industry. I don't know, maybe I'll think of something better than that.
It's surprisingly rare to find someone who's like a PA or an intern who is like, has a really good attitude and is like really positive about whatever you tell them to do. And like, I feel like every time I like had an internship or when I was a PA, it was like, amazed that people were acting like I was doing a good job when all I was doing was just like being punctual and like being like sure when someone told me to do something. And I think that that really goes a long way, like doing the thing you're asked to do really well, as opposed to like trying to convince everyone that you're like a really great director when like you're supposed to be getting lunch orders, you know? So, and I think like it actually is really hierarchical, like when in the production world's really high, they all are really hierarchical, and just like being doing really well at the job that you have at, you know, at the very entry level position or whatever is like people will actually notice and give you more opportunities if you're just like a nice person to have in the room who works hard and doesn't cause problems. And then one other thing that I think is interesting just in terms of people's, that I'm always surprised by how little entertainment is prioritized in people's like writing and stuff. And that I've like, when I've tried to, the people who I've shown scripts to who've liked it, because I really deliberately try to write things that I think are like fun to watch, like the kind of things that I would like want to watch at like Netflix, on Netflix after work or whatever. And I think to the extent that people have responded to the stuff I've written, and have, you know, like I've working with a producer now, and she really reiterated exactly what I was hoping someone was going to say, which is like, oh, it seems like something that'd be really fun to watch, and that's, you know, a nice thing to read. So,
I would say, you know, had I known the daunting odds it was going to be, you know, that are to sell a independent film, I'm not sure that I would have even made my first film. You know, like, there was almost like an ignorance is bliss kind of thing. Like, I had no idea how, we just got lucky as lucky could be. We got a great rough cut to a guy at HBO who happens, his kid was being coached by a friend of mine on the lacrosse team in like Rye, New York. I mean, it was just, you know, one thing after, it wasn't meant to be. I guess it was meant to be, but like, I had no real plan. And, you know, I like to, and I've never had a golden parachute or anything. For me, it's been a business too. I kind of tell people, like, you know, when they come up with a documentary idea, I'm like, the first thing I say, who's your audience or what network's gonna air this, especially with documentaries, because, you know, there's only a couple places you can actually make money, and most of that is network TV. In fact, probably all of it is. You know, at some point, that's either got to be your first or second window. So I like to think, like, know your audience. Where are you gonna see this before you, like, go out and spend, you know, your dad's money or your friend's money or whatnot. And then the second thing, again, I'm talking specifically about documentaries because that's what I've had some success in, is get access to whatever the story is. Okay, so if you want to, like, if you're really into the environment, let's say, and you want to make a documentary on like whales or something, you know, well, that's great, but why are they going to hire you to make a documentary on whales when, you know, they can do it themselves? The network can do it, you know, Discovery Channel can do it. But if you go into that network meeting or you get access to that fisherman who's out there, you know, killing whales, or maybe somebody on the front lines that's saving whales, and you get that footage, then you have something in your back pocket that you can go into a network with. So get your access, some kind of access, whether it's your subject, whether it's some kind of footage that's been, you know, in a storage unit for 100 years or 50 years, whatever. But get access, know your audience. Those are things that I didn't know at all when I first started, and I've kind of learned along the way, and I think those are really important things to know before you make a documentary, or at least, you know, go full bore into production.
I mean, if you think about that question, there's something about, and this is just going back maybe because of the introduction, I was thinking about people that I started with. Like, one was that I remember is just like, finish your drafts, like, you know, finish the scripts, because like, I just, some of the most talented people I started with never finished their scripts, so things never happened. And then at the same time, I think you got to be precious about them, and yet open about finding ways to present them and get them out there. So there's like that twofold thing, like, because you have to be really protective of them, and at the same time you need to be brave enough to show them out there. But I remember like the most talented people just didn't finish drafts. Like, they never got to the end. They just kept working on stuff over and over again, and it just ended up going away. And because at some moment, there will be a moment if you're finishing drafts, if you're writing script after script, or working on at least a couple of them, and then there'll be a moment where you get to present them. There'll be a moment when you have a conversation with the assistant of somebody's assistant, and that conversation is going to be about you as a writer, as a creator, as a filmmaker, and you're going to have to present like not just one idea, but two or three ideas passionately in a way that's like you're the only one that can get them done. And I think you want to be ready for that moment. And again, it's like this, it's hard. You got to be courageous about it because you take some hits. I mean, people go, you know, whoever's presented their own works, you know what I'm saying? You'll have people be like, well, if I was you, I'd sit on a boat. And you know what I mean? Like, it's like you get hit with some stuff that comes back at you. And then when you do finally get, as far as like things that I didn't know when I first got my first round of professional meetings was, you know, all the notes are good. Even if you can't do them, they're all good. I would get into like these fights about notes and think that this was some sort of process. And also, they're really smart people giving you notes. They just operate from a different place. There's fear involved. They have commercial pressure they're under. But all their notes are good in a way. Like, what I wish I'd known was to create a positive working relationship with the people who are giving me notes and trying to help me get this thing done, instead of thinking that it had to be combative and like I had some, you know, really special vision of my piece. But learning how to negotiate that at the same time that I am, do still secretly think I have a special, like I know what my piece is, but learning how to do that was something I wish I knew better when I had started out.
Okay, so another, I think, important question for a lot of, you know, the people still in school. How do you break in as a director, writer, producer? I know there are a lot of different paths that people take to get there, but what would you say are, like, the most mainstream paths that, or the easiest paths to take to get to that point?
I think we should go.
You don't have to go in order.
You know, I have, from the moment, I got lucky enough to be like a playwright in residence at the Royal Court, and there was a bunch of writers there, and they would set up these collectives and these writers groups. And when I came back to New York, I set up a bunch of these writers groups. And in a weird way, I don't know, like the business works so much on like creating these like circles, concentric circles of exclusivity that you keep feeling like you have to penetrate to get closer and closer to something. And then every time you get there, there's like another circle they won't let you in. So it's a little bit like, let's have our own circle. I had a writer's group for 10 years. I've been in other writer's groups. It was like a cliquish of 6, 7, 8 people working together. And at some point, like you helped each other out, and even we moved to LA together. And then at some point, we started presenting our work to people just on readings or, you know, like even living room readings. And like a little bit buzz got around, and next thing you know, a couple of assistant agents showed up or producers, and stuff started happening. I mean, You Can Count on Me came out of the writer's group. Like, it was a script that was developed in this writer's group, and then people got turned on by it. So, I don't know, it was a way to just, at some point, someone has to hear what you're doing for you to get that connection you need to get into the professional, let's say, the first circle of this, that business.
I would say the easiest way to become a director is really simple. Call yourself a director. I literally, that's like anything in life. You want to be that, you got to be it first. You got to believe yourself that that's who you are, and then present yourself as a director. And that's really, really as easy as it is. I can tell you from my experience, so when I first started making this, going back to Assault in the Ring, I was going to be the executive producer, and I hired someone that was going to direct the film. And so what happened was I went to one shoot, the first shoot, he was there, and he's doing an interview with somebody that I had set up. And I was like, well, ask him this, ask him that, ask him this. And by the end of it, I was basically, kind of like on over him asking questions, which had to be the most annoying thing in the world for him. In fact, if that ever happened to me again, I'd probably strangle me. But anyway, and then afterwards, and then he couldn't make it, and he wasn't passionate about it. And I was like, you know what? let's sever this relationship. I actually paid him what I agreed to, the full amount, and I said, you know what, I'm gonna be the director of this. And I took it back, and at that moment, I knew that that was right, because it was my film, it was my story, and I got some great advice from a really prolific producer named Eisen Robbins. You guys, if you know the independent world, you might have heard his name. He's produced a lot of independent films. And he's like, never give up the director credit. And I was like, oh, yeah, well, that's fine. Well, now that I have, he goes, never give up the director credit. So going along the way, I'm making Assault in the Ring. I get to HBO. It was HBO Sports. And back before I sold this, they didn't have director credit for their documentaries at HBO Sports. In fact, they did all of their documentaries in-house, executive produced by, it was Ross Greenberg at the time, and Rick Bernstein, and then it was producer, and this a writer, but there was no director for the documentaries. And so they didn't want to give me director, and I said, no way. I want director. And that's when that fight started happening. And I kept my, you know, and look, they offered me not a lot of money at first. And I was just like, you know, so scared. I was like, okay, you know, it was a terrible negotiation, but that's usually the way it is for your first film. But I held on to that director's credit. And that's one of the best things that I've done, because, you know, then I'm a director. You know, and you know, at first I say I'm a director, and then I might get my credit as a director, and then, you know, and then now on HBO Sports documentaries, on ESPN films, 30 for 30s, everybody, there's director, director, director. But it wasn't so common back then. I mean, this was only 2009 too. So my advice is, you want to be a director, call yourself a director, and that's who you are. And don't give up that credit, no matter who tries to take it away from you.
One thing I'd say is there is, right now, particularly in New York, there's a lot of work. There's a lot of production work, and there's a lot of post-production work. So this isn't so much directly being a director or writer, but if it's like a very attainable profession right now. And so like anyone who wants to, you know, there's a lot of PA positions available that you can just like find online or by, you know, like Mandy, whatever. I think once you kind of get an internship or get a PA position, there is a lot of work. And like I have a lot of friends now who, you know, you're kind of like, oh, I guess it seems sort of overly ambitious to try to work in the movie business or whatever, but it's like kind of not, at least for the below the line crew stuff, that if you kind of get one PA position, then maybe you have to have like one or two more PA positions. And then, you know, at that point you've been around, you can kind of have a sense of if you're interested in the camera department or if you're interested in post-production. And it is actually very possible, particularly right now, because there's this big tax rebate in New York State, so there's like tons of production and post happening, that it's a real thing you can do. And even though my like eventual aspirations is to write and direct, I love the feeling now of having like a kind of comfy below the line crew training, and that there's like, I have like a skill, you know, I can sound edit and I can edit and I have my little thing I can do, and you know, you meet people who work in the film industry through doing that, and it's like a job. And then it's like, you don't have to have a day job while you're directing. You can, I mean, it's hard, it's, the hours are really bad sometimes and you know, all that, but I'd say that it is really like, everyone I know at this point who's like made a serious concerted effort to work in film is working in film and doing well, because there's a lot of open opportunities.
I agree with all this. I obviously kind of only come from it as like a filmmaker. I haven't tried to work, you know, as an assistant editor or something like that. But that sounds very true what you're saying. But I agree that the only thing that you need to do in order to be a director is consistently make films, and you have to finish the films. There are so many talented people that I know that who are making things, making shorts, and they just don't get finished and they fizzle out, and it's like they get concerned about something that isn't perfect about it, and they just let it sit, and it just ends up not being done. And then, you know, if it is done, it could play at a film festival, you could show it to someone. I mean, that just builds upon the work that you can do. And it's entirely, from my perspective, about your own initiative, at least if you're trying to be a film director or film writer or both or whatever. You have to push your, no one else is going to tell you to write every day. No one else is going to tell you to, you know, spend absurd amounts of money to make short films that are really just practice. But they're all these things are very necessary. Yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree with finishing things. We're saying it a lot, but especially with scripts, it's kind of very easy to, you know, it's not easy to write a script, but it's kind of easy to write a script. You show it to somebody, doesn't work for them, and you're just like, oh, whatever, I'll just, you know, whatever, I'll just put it aside and just write another. No, just, like, rewrite it, I guess. Like, and, like, we, like, spend so much time rewriting, and many times, like, most of the scripts that we write are not going to get made, but, like, I guess you get, you know, all the professors say that to us, and I guess you hear that a lot, but writing is rewriting. The sense is like, maybe it needs another draft. Like, you know, keep going. But something that I think is also very important, or at least has been very important for me, and all the jobs that I have gotten so far, well, now I got one that's not because of that, but all the jobs are because of my friends, or the people that before the MFA I helped, just because I wanted to help them, because they were my friends and I was having fun with them on set and I loved them and I loved what they were doing and I wanted to try to help them in what they were doing. Then when I was doing my short, they all came and helped me and didn't sleep for 4 days because they were helping me. You really need those people. I feel like I would feel really lonely if I didn't have those people, and I really wouldn't know how to. And in a very organic way, you know, some of my friends now are producers in Spain, and they want to help me produce my, you know, maybe my next film, let's hope, or something. Or even with my friends here, you know, now I have a friend who's a producer working this company, and now she gives us work as, you know, as readers or as, you know. If you're generous with other people, then it comes back to you, and film is such a collaborative art. Like, you need other people. That's like, so if you find a group of people that you get along with and that you share, you know, the same taste, and then you can watch films together and break them down, and you know, I think that's really important. At least to not feel alone at the beginning, because I think it's very, the way I saw it when I came out of undergrad, I was like, whoa, this is, it looked impossible. I was like, this huge business, and what am I gonna do? You know, I'm all alone. And then I started meeting all these people, and I was like, oh, you know what, it's not that hard. I'm just gonna go work with this person, and then this, and then that. And it's so much easier. Like, that for me is super important.
I think there's a little bit of, like, there's a myth about the business a little bit that you kind of get anointed or, like, you win a lottery ticket or something. And luck is definitely part of it. Like, sometimes you're in the right place at the right time, but you kind of generate the opportunity to be in the right place at the right time. And the idea of finishing drafts or, like you said, like, just do another draft of something that maybe someone doesn't like. I mean, I just did a pilot for Warp Films. They're, like, a London-based company, and kind of connected with ITV, and we did 27 drafts. I mean, it came out really good. Like, I think it's really good, but it was 27 drafts later when it was really good. Like, I don't know. I mean, you could stop after 3 drafts, I guess, but there's just, like, a certain amount of it is just work, you know?
And I think also if you're gonna make something, if you wanna direct something, really take the time to make sure you're happy with the script before directing it. Like, in any kind of short feature, whatever. I've definitely had experiences where I've made little shorts and then realized, like, well, I learned some stuff for it, but I probably should have, like, had a better sense of what the ending was going to be before starting it, you know. And that, and I was telling Jason that I'm working now as an assistant on this, like, big studio movie, and the script, you know, we've now shot the movie that was based on the script. And it's, you know, it's good. The performances are good. It's a good version of the script. And now the producers are having all these problems with these story points that are exactly the same as what were in the script, you know? So it's this, like, weird, confusing thing of, like, well, this problem was there in the script first, you know? And there's like that cliche line of, like, you can't make a
good movie from a bad script, and I feel like that is true. And this has been a very interesting experience of seeing, like, on a big scale, the exact same thing happen as, you know, has happened to, like, me and all my friends on little, their own little tiny things.
I also wanted to say that, you know, there hasn't been a single project that I've worked on,
and now I've worked on a lot, that there was a moment where I was like, this is crap. I mean, nobody's gonna watch this. They're never gonna sign off on this. Every single project I've worked on, I wanted to just hide under my desk and just be like, it's over. And you know, that is the defining moment if you wanna be in this business or be successful in any business, is to just keep moving forward, you know, and just say, okay, well, what can I do? Just like it was said, you know, just gotta keep working. You know, this is not, never gonna make something, you know, if you're lazy. You're never gonna make something if you quit, you know, and there's gonna be times, there were times for me where I did not believe in what I was doing, because all of a sudden these voices came into my head that said, nobody's gonna like this, what's the point, this and that. And my only advice to that is to talk to your friends, you know, get people to watch what you're, you know, at all stages of what you're doing, you know, get a lot of feedback. I ask people for opinions. We have interns, I get them in the edit room, I get everybody, I wanna hear everybody. Doesn't mean I'm gonna listen to it, but I want as much, you know, input and opinions. I wanna hear what people think. You never know what will come out of, you know, the person that you wouldn't expect it. I once showed something to the guy that was delivering for FedEx. You know, I was like, can you just come in? Oh, you like this? Can you come, you know, this sport? You know, can you watch this? And I got some valuable feedback. So be open to that and know that, you know, I don't know about writing a script, but I do know about making, you know, a film, you know, that there's always a moment where you're like, this is the horrible. So, you know, if you can get through that, usually you can get to a better place.
It's interesting about, you know, if you get notes that you completely don't agree with, they usually have some kind of instructive thing about them where you can recognize how to approach something slightly differently to make someone who has that thinking understand the the project more or whatever. It's all, yeah, valuable, everything that you can, all the feedback you can get.
Okay. What do you guys look for in potential assistants or candidates for a job? We touched upon this a little bit, you know, people who are hardworking, people who have a positive attitude, but are there, I guess, like specific things?
I can talk about this,
obviously, but I mean, I guess I can talk about collaborators. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that the most important thing for me, besides like people being generous, like, it's that they are honest with what I do. Like, I'd rather somebody tells me this is shit than like somebody tells me, you know, this kind of works, yeah, keep going. Like, I hate this. I really like when somebody, and I guess it's like what, you know, your true friends will do for you, is be like, you know what, this is really bad, so you should, you know, and it's really, it's great. I want to have people around me who are going to tell me that, and I want to be able to tell my friends that. So I guess that's, for me, the most important thing.
Whenever I do a project, I as much as I can, I didn't get to do it as much as I would have liked on my very last thing, but usually I meet everyone who's going to be involved with the crew, all the assistants, everybody, and because it helps that, you know, when you're shooting, you want everyone to kind of be on the same page, and part of that has to do with just kind of a spirit of not coming into a project as though it's just a job, and actually having an interest in, you know, whatever it is, the subject matter, the type of film that we're making, and just an understanding of the art form in a sense, and I think that's really valuable. Sometimes you meet with people who are very disgruntled, and they're kind of like and it's very subtle in the sense of like they're not appreciating the art form of it. They're just treating it as, you know, a 9-to-5 sort of thing, and that would be one thing that I try to avoid, I suppose.
Yeah, disgruntled
people are annoying, because it's like, you know, it's always like it's stressful and it's long hours and everyone's like there because they want to, you know, it should feel like everyone's there because they want to be there. It's like not an industry that, you know, as you're saying, you get in because it's like an easy way to make $1 million or whatever. And I'm just repeating myself, I know, but like I really can't emphasize enough the like positive attitude among assistants and PAs, and like it's just so, it's so immediately recognized that like everyone I know, it's like if you're like, oh God, I like the PA is so great, like she's just like, it's not, you know, just like what seems like should be totally minor things is like completely appreciated if someone is just like, doesn't make you feel kind of bad for asking them to do stuff that really is their job, but everyone, you know, it's like kind of, you know, sometimes you kind of feel bad asking like a art department PA to like clean up this wall or, you know, whatever. It's kind of like a lot of the work is pretty like drudgery work, but the PAs who are like, or the interns who are like, oh yeah, great, you know, I cleaned the wall, what can I do now? It's just like such a relief than you know, there's a lot of who are kind of like, and seem sort of like you're asking them to do something beneath them or whatever, and it's just like adds so much stress for everyone.
So I've been running my business now for 10 years, and we've had, I can't even tell you how many people have worked for us. And so I've seen all types of people come through and interviews, and you know, I've seen really people with great attitudes too that are like, I want to do it, I want to do it, and then they still don't pan out. But I would agree that like that is one of the important criteria, that they should have a good attitude. I look for people as far as assistants, if that's what you're looking at, if that was the question, you know, they got to be uber organized. They've got to be self-starters. Like, I don't want to be like, you know, what do I do? One of the questions that I hate the most when, you know, in the office setting is, what do you want me to do next? Now, I know if I haven't done my job right and I've just kind of thrown them in, then that's a legitimate question. But there's so much to do at all times. We look for people that like are somewhat intuitive. They can kind of think of on their own. You know, when there's not something pressing, then that they can go and start like, oh, you know, maybe we should start making a credit list. Maybe we should start making crew lists, shoot sheets, organizing, licenses. You know, there's a lot that goes into making documentaries, a lot of paperwork. So I look for, you know, number one, somebody that's smart, somebody that's, you know, good attitude, very organized, can work, you know, well on their own, you know, self-starters, you know, yes, passionate, you know, but it seems like everybody that comes in wants to work in the business, you know, as it's been said. But those are the most important things, and that's probably, you know, translatable to most professions, these qualities. But, you know, more so for a small production company, we really want someone that can hold their own weight. And experience is the last thing I usually look at, because I was told when I started at CNN, I spoke to the president at the time, and he's like, oh, you know, because that was one of the other privileges of being the low man on the totem pole at CNN. You got to meet the president with this, you know, low salary. And I remember sitting there, and he's like, oh yeah, you know, where'd you go to school? And I was like, I went to Columbia. He goes, oh, what'd you study? I said, I studied political science. I know I should have probably studied journalism. He's like, no. We don't want people that study journalism here. I'm like, CNN, you don't want people that study journalism. If there's ever a place, he goes, we want people that come to the table and know how to think, and we can teach you journalism. And that's the same thing with my business. You know, what I do, we can teach you how to do all this stuff. If you've got, you know, the fundamentals, you know, that's the most important thing.
Yeah, I would echo a lot of that stuff. And in particular, TV, you know, there's a real writer's room setting. And when you're working on a show, there's like an artisanal sort of like old school, like painter studio. Like you bring people in on a low level and you actually train them to become producers and writers along the way. So early on, we definitely look for people. And some of this you can't do anything about. Like it's just about music a little bit. It's like the show or your writing has a certain music, and you just want to know that the person you're working with hears the same music you hear. Some of that stuff, I don't know what you do about. It's just a conversation, and you click in a way. And if you don't, I don't even think it's worth it in a way. But we do also look for people that are, if self-starter is a great word, or just, I don't know, like present. I don't know, like a presence that you go, okay, they're gonna be here, they're present, they're not on their way out or thinking about what just happened before they got here. They're kind of here and doing it with me because I need people here to do it with me. And like, I come from like, my mentor was like Tom Fontana, and he would bring people all different kinds, sort of like had the same feeling about what the show was, had different traits that they could use, were willing to be there all the time and work on it together in a communal way. And we would like have lunch every day for an hour and a half and like talk about everything. And it just created this sort of energy, this sort of community, this sort of feeling that we were all in it together. So there's like a nice collegial aspect to it. So I think that's what I look for, but primarily is that thing about, at least we're on the same page about what we hear here.
Thank you. Also one thing that I personally thought that I've gotten a lot of advice on and everything is people really like people who are intuitive or common sense, you know, on a set. When if something looks dangerous, you should probably say something. I've realized that there are a lot of PAs who don't do that. That was my personal experience.
Throw in one other thing. If you're going into an interview, do your homework. I can't tell you how many people we've had sitting on the couch, in my office.
We're all around because I like to interview people in a group setting. And we're like, so do you like sports? And they're like, no. And I'm like, did you read our website? We do a lot of sports programming here. Know what you're getting into. And that's not necessarily a prerequisite that you love sports, because we want people that can think and can do things on their own. But like, know what you're talking, before you go into the interview, do a little research, try to anticipate the kinds of questions that are going to be asked of you for that environment.
We kind of touched upon this a little bit before, but biggest pet peeves of like the industry or the people in the industry or, experiences that you just generally found?
Yes is usually, yes many times is maybe. That's a big pet peeve. There's no really yes until you're actually on set behind a camera. It just drives you insane. It's really nerve-wracking.
My pet peeve, and
I've pretty much veered away from it just because I don't have to deal with it, is like the LA mentality, like where like the assistant's like, oh, let me see if I can get them. The whole agents and that world, that's a pet peeve of mine. I've been fortunate enough to just go direct to the source, to the networks. You got to be aggressive, persistent. If you want something bad enough, you can get it. There's no reason anybody in this room can't get to whoever they need to get to and talk to whoever they got to get to. So my biggest pet peeve is all the layers of BS that exists from LA. Like, if you want to get something done, do it in New York. That's my opinion. That's the way I've done it, and that's my pet peeve, if I'm going to be honest.
What was that Bill Murray story? Like, he didn't have an agent, right? He doesn't have an agent.
I think he still doesn't.
He doesn't have an agent. He just has a phone number.
Right.
And there's that story where someone was calling and calling 25, 35 rings over and over again. And he finally picked up the phone, and on the other side, they're like, could you please hold for a second? And it was some LA agent's assistant calling, and he just immediately hung up. But it was like that LA thing just right there.
Yeah, there's a reason why a lot of stuff doesn't get done there.
The hours are really bad.
That's a true thing. The thing that's nice about it is that because it's project-based, it's like, I'm talking about crew work, it's like, at least you can take time in between. And sometimes, at least part of what I like about working in post-production as opposed to on set is like things can be a little bit more flexible. That, I have a boss who's my editor, is like pretty nice about it. If I say like, I have a doctor's appointment, can I leave early? He'll generally say yes, but the hours are, can be like pretty punishing.
Something that just comes to mind is, at least from the director's standpoint, that and I'm guilty of it myself, but it's really frustrating to come up against people telling you you can't do something just because they don't want to have to go through the work of doing it, And that's something kind of, you know, to do with assistance as well. Like, you can tell if someone has like an attitude where they're going to try to skirt things just because it's like, oh, I don't think that can be done. I don't know. But yeah, I don't know.
I'm from Spain, so. First, it's the first time I heard the word pet peeve, which is really interesting, and I figured out as you were talking. Oh, that's what it means. So, I have a different vision about this, because in Spain they don't pay screenwriters well. It's not and here I was very surprised to realize that it's a better well regarded, like, they. You know, they have very strong guild, and like, it's a well-regarded profession. You know, in Spain, it's like, I'm a screenwriter. It's like, oh, good luck. You know, it's like, so something that has always frustrated me a lot is that in Spain they have this thing that it's like, can you write me a draft of this feature that we want to make, and if we make it, we're gonna pay you. And it's like, excuse me, like, you know, it's, but they keep asking me to do that, and it's like, it's this thing, maybe because I've been here for a while, and I know that it shouldn't work like that. It frustrates me so much that sometimes, since it's a thing that we love doing, they don't treat it as a profession. They don't think that we have to like pay rent and things like that. And you know, you're young and everything, but the fact that we are young doesn't mean that we have to get paid, you know? Mm-hmm. So this is the thing, that how to like get people to understand that even if you're young and you're starting and everything, you still deserve to get paid, even if it's not like a lot of money, but to, you know, you need to pay rent unless you have very rich parents. But even if you do, you need to pay rent, you know? So this is one of the things that has frustrated me a little bit about the industry. Many times, I don't know if you've had the same experiences at the beginning. And I understand that sometimes you have to take certain jobs for free, especially for your friends and but there are, you know, I think it's important to learn when to say no, I think.
Yeah.
I'm, you know, discovering this right now, and it's difficult because you want to do it. You really want to do it. It's just like, you know.
In what ways has your education at Columbia directly affected your career? Whether it was, you know, your core education or at, you know, in the School of the Arts. Like, how do you feel like Columbia has, you know, helped your career, and what resources did you find here that were helpful and that you took advantage of?
I would say I don't know if there's a direct link from my actual studies to what I do.
I would say that the radio, as I mentioned before, the radio station was amazing. So my only thing I always like to say is just be open to anything, say yes, you know, just keep your eyes wide open and, you know, try to look for opportunities or, you know, just go. You know, I went to a boxing match, you know, somebody was like, go. I was like, all right, you know, I didn't want to, and that's what happened. So I don't know if there's anything directly from that I learned studying Demosthenes or, I don't know, whatever, you know, Sophocles or, you know, nothing that I do now had anything to do with anything I studied. Sorry, Columbia. I hope that's not going to come back and bite me. But.
The film production program here is very practical.
So a lot of things are they tie directly in. Every day you're faced with something that probably came up at some point in that program. It seems like you guys are, you know, you're not currently film students, most of you, at Columbia, your film studies may be going into production. If so, something maybe to know is just like the difference between something like Columbia and other film schools. Columbia, for instance, is very based around kind of the theory of how to create narrative films, the kind of theory of what a shot means, how to construct a narrative, what are the kind of principles of making something that will be functional for drama, for an audience, whereas other schools are more geared towards the equipment and And sometimes that's really necessary. There are a lot of my classmates who had no background at all in the physicality of production, and I can imagine that was very challenging for them because you get thrown right into making things, but you don't know how to use the editing software or whatnot. So it helps. I don't know how to give any advice aside from I actually think it's really beneficial to do two different programs. But if you're considering Columbia's program, you should be, I guess, aware of that you want to be on the, it's really a director and writer type of school. It's not for crewing. It's not for learning how to be a crew member necessarily, although it probably helps having an understanding of narrative from that standpoint.
Yeah, I think I totally agree. And I'm in the same program. I mean, he's already left. But one of the things that I think I value a lot from the program is I've really learned how to give feedback, because you're constantly giving feedback all the time. And that's so valuable.
And how to accept feedback.
Yeah, it's really valuable, because that's what we're doing all the time. And we have such the training giving feedback. Yeah, it's a really good program. It's very story-based. And it really gives you like a set of tools that you can, for example, like a lot of people are not really that interested in like classical directing. Maybe they are more interested in, but it gives you all these rules and all these perspectives, and then you have to choose what you want to do. They are not gonna be like, so that's how you do it, or that's how. So there are like all these ways to do this, and you have to choose which one you want, what goes with your vision. So, I don't know, it's a lot of work, but it's great work, so.
I went to Cornell.
At NYU, so it's really different. I could pitch a little bit for the program. I do think that what's really great about the film program is a little bit, you guys hit on a little bit, is that you guys walk away as groups. There's like groups of people. The thing that's great about Columbia Film is people walk away as groups and they work together as groups when they leave the school, and it translates into an extended period of time, and you can see it's really, there's a force to it once they get in the business that I've noticed over the last 4 or 5 years.
Do you guys think there's any benefit to making student films, webcasts, YouTube videos, et cetera? Does it help you get your foot in the door?
I think it helps to have work that is representative of the type of work that you want to make. I also find, though, that a lot of students make irresponsibly large productions just because they want to make a big production, and that can be a problem. But at the same time, if you want to eventually make big films, you have to make them, you have to make your student work on a certain scale so that you understand, you know, how to work with the dollies that might be available to you when you're making bigger films or whatnot. And so I think they're very beneficial, but you have to be very careful. You can't, you should just try to be as responsible as possible about the money you're actually spending.
Well, I think it's crucial. Like, I just made a short, but I talk about it as my first short, but I had made six shorts before that short. But I consider them like exercises, like training. Because film is a language, right? And unless you're like training, you know, as an almost like an athlete, it's like writing scripts. It's very hard that you write the first script and it's very good. I think it's almost impossible. So it's just you have to train. So all these films, all these hours that you're gonna spend on set, or the hours that you're gonna spend writing or making student films, are gonna make your films better, your next films better. So I just think there's really no way around it.
Yeah, definitely. I think so too. And the thing that's interesting is
that the process is pretty much the same, you know, on your little thing that like you're making on your computer and a full big studio production. It's kind of like the same stuff needs to happen. And when you're doing everything yourself, you realize all the stages, and then the bigger the production gets, you're like, okay, so now these people can do that part of it, and these people can do that part, and these people can do that part, you know, until you're in a full crew situation. But it's all the same work. It's like, you know, you have to prep the same stuff, you have to get your locations, you have to get make sure you have food, you have to, you know, do all that stuff, and then it's your actors, and then it's like when you're post, you know, even if the actors are just yourself or whatever, and then you have to like edit it and make sure the sound works, and it's the exact same process. It's just that it grows. And so I think, like, definitely.
100%.
Can I ask though, I mean, do you guys feel like you should make more than one film? Like, I've noticed people banking all on one film, and then there's people who make like a big, a small, medium, and that seem, I don't, they seem to do better, but I don't know what you guys think.
Something that is great about Columbia's program that was different from my undergraduate program. My undergraduate program, you would, in your third year, you made a big film, and in your last year, you made a final big film. And what, but whereas at Columbia, you're making exercises all the time, and I think that's more beneficial. It's good to do a lot of that exercising, that like an athlete or whatever, because it's just getting your in the mindset of how to achieve. Yeah, totally.
Yeah, a lot of it is just like two actors and one like a Canon camera, and that like in a room with your friends, and those are really helpful because you don't spend like, you're probably just gonna buy some bagels from your friend, for your friends or something like that, but you actually learn where to put the camera and if the shots work. So this is like, this I find this super helpful, just to even, you can take your own camera and with go with your friends and just shoot something, and the, and you learn so much just from deciding where to put the camera or trying to direct actors.
And there's a professor, Eric Mendelson, who is one of the great directing professors here, who came from a art background, and he describes doing these exercises as similar to like sketching out something before you actually paint it, or you know, it's to be have the freedom to just sketch something and throw it away is necessary, especially when, you know, you're trying to do a big production. It's such a lot of pressure to try to get things right, and you're not really able to experiment as you might if there aren't any consequences. So it helps to make a lot of small things. At the same time, though, again, there's a certain level of production if you're trying to make big films that you're not really going to learn unless you go all the way. So at a certain point, you have to kind of do a full-on production, I would say,
well,
at least one.
I'm interested in your, how different, let's see, for the experience of,
let's say, having like a 12-person crew and you're trying to make a short over 4 days, you know, something that like that compared to your experience of like a, you know, whatever, the full crew, a 200-person crew.
I had come from making somewhat big shorts, and I was a cinematographer as well, so I was making shorts and working as a cinematographer on features where we had a fairly big crews, pretty much the same size as what I had in this feature, but time is really incredibly valuable. When you're working on a smaller scale, you're allowed to just take more of your time, and if you can scale down your production, it can help you to and, you know, allow you more freedom to work with the actors more, to get the shots right actually, and all that. I mean, the trickier thing regarding that last film would just had more to do with the apparatus surrounding it and all of like the conflicting viewpoints of what type of film should be made. It's, you know, so it helps to keep things small or just surround yourself with people who you really have come to, you know, an agreement or you know, not necessarily agreement, but finding people who have the same kind of viewpoints that you have on the films that you're going to make, because it's hard to convince someone of, you know, something that might seem completely counterintuitive if you don't have the same tastes at all down the road.
Okay, networking tips. Do you guys have,
you know, any big networking tips? And how do you go from, for example, like your internships to your first paid job? How do you just, you know, when you're first getting into the industry, how do you deal with like the competition, impress your boss, and like make that leap from, you know, being a small-time PA or an intern or whatever, and actually making it in the business?
Yeah.
I don't know. I said yes a lot. I mean, you know. And the yeses all turned out to be really kind of a, some of them were horrible, and you get out of them, you got to learn how to get out of it also. But some of them turned out to be great opportunities. I mean, I got to hang out with Errol Morris for like a year just working on his films. I mean, that just was because he needed somebody, and I was like, I'll do it. I don't care. I'll just show up and do whatever you need me to do. You know, so some of that is just jumping in when the opportunity, taking the opportunity and seeing what the next opportunity is from the opportunity you just took.
There's an organization called the IFP, the Independent Film Project, which you know, was really helpful. They have like a, they really support first-time filmmakers. They support, you know, independent films. That's a great place to network. So I would suggest, you know, if you're going to find a good place, to, you know, if you want a place to like be involved, and you don't, you know, the entry fee is very, you know, very minimal, I would say, you know, that would be a great place to be.
Yeah, I feel like networking events are like so horrible, but I've actually, I've like full on gotten a job from one once, and I've had like, you know, met people, like they actually really can be really valuable. Like for post-production particularly, there's one, there's this thing called Post Alliance that like, you know, it's like a monthly party kind of thing, and like, you know, I never want to go, and it's like, oh God, this is so horrible. And then, you know, just kind of go and like introduce yourself to people and get 10 people's email addresses and just email them a bunch of times. And like, it's usually how, for in my experience, that's how I've gotten jobs, of just like getting some email addresses and like harassing people. I mean, this current job that I have, like I got the email address of like a post executive at Fox, and I emailed him like every 2 weeks and was just like, do you have anything now? Do you have anything now? Do you have anything now? And it was just like, no, but feel free to email me again, you know, and I just kept emailing him, and eventually he was like, oh yeah, I actually do have something, you know, and sent me to meet the post supervisor, and she liked me enough that she sent me to meet the editor, and that's how I got the job. It was really just by like harassing that guy. And like that's been pretty consistent. That's been my experience.
Yeah, it does help to keep up with you. Yeah. I personally am a horrible networker. I'm not tremendously good socially. There was a time in my life where I spent years practically just like locked in my apartment, just like writing and watching films and stuff. So it really takes a toll on your ability to be social. But something that was really valuable about Columbia actually is that it consistently forces you to talk about the work that you're doing, and to be able to articulate what you're working on and be brief about what it is that you're doing and things that you're interested in, and it's incredibly helpful. So it helps to practice that to some degree and just meet people as much as you can and just keep encouraging that fluidity in yourself. If you're a somewhat antisocial person like myself.
I think Columbia has helped a lot with that. Something that nobody ever told me, and it's that it's very, because I was in a director before, and as a screenwriter, you don't go that much to festivals, I guess. But it's very important to go to, if your film gets into a festival, go to the festival. Like it's such a great place just to meet other like filmmakers who are making stuff that you can like share, and if you don't go, it's almost as if the film wasn't there in a way. So going to festivals is very important.
And even great if places, it's an people investment. Really care about films at film festivals. Can be a great atmosphere.
It is an investment because most festivals here don't pay for the tickets, but it's worth it. You know, making a film is so expensive that you might just like also go to the festivals if the film gets into festivals. And I think something that a producer told me once in Spain, I thought was very important, is that I like it when people are excited when they talk about their projects, because it makes me excited and it made me think, and I thought that was really important. If you talk about something, you're excited about it and you're very passionate about it, people somehow get excited as well. So I try to do it, even if I'm tired, to like, you know, even if I've told the same story, you know, again and again for like one evening, I try to like sound excited all the time. I am excited about it, but I'm probably just tired at the end of it. But
you know.
It doesn't help to be as honest as you probably feel and all the terror that you feel about exactly. making this shitty thing.
Deep down you're like, it's probably gonna be shitty, but it's gonna be great.
You have to tune into that part of you that actually appreciates what you're working on, yeah.
Yes. One great piece of advice that I got about going to festivals is always bring a lighter and gum or mints, because when you're in line, someone will always ask you for one.
Oh.
That's, you know, but yeah. All right, for the women on the panel, how has being a woman worked for or against you? A lot of people consider Hollywood and filmmaking a boys' club. Do you agree or disagree?
Well, what's your experience been as a director? I'm interested.
I've never had any problems, but I think I've been really lucky. Like, everybody has always given me opportunities. But also, I don't know, I have a feeling, I feel it in the industry. I feel it's there, and I'm afraid of the moment that I'm going to encounter it. It hasn't happened so far, but I've always tried to surround myself with, you know, people who are not sexist, who are like, you know, who respect people for who they are, not because of their genre or like where they come from or like, you know. And especially, like, I feel Colombia, New York is like a great place to be, because it's, you know, we are people from all over the world, and it's like from all, you know, like, it's like doesn't it really, I felt that it doesn't really matter, that what matters is what you want to do and you want to tell. That should be the case everywhere. And I think it's important we kind of like, you know, and I think that a lot of men are on board with us and are trying to help the industry be more just, but I think it's important to kind of like have this solidarity among women and try to help each other. So, you know, we kind of like balance things a little bit.
Yeah, I felt there to be a pretty distinct New York LA divide on this, that I've been surprised by some of the stuff I've heard, like very nice, like male, you know, editors or producers or whatever say. Like, I think genuinely a lot of like Hollywood people think that like stories about women are boring. And it's like not, they're not like being sexist, you know, it's just kind of like, oh, well, it's just, I'm not that interested if the protagonist is a woman. Like, I've heard people say that like pretty much word for word. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's so surprising, because it's like, this guy, he's a nice, you know, I've never been disrespected by this man. I never feel like he treats me differently because I'm a woman. And then literally like, I don't think I'm sexist, I just don't really like stuff by or about women. That was like pretty much a direct quote that someone said to me the other day, like at lunch. It's the kind of thing that I don't know. I don't really know what you do with that, other than you just kind of like, just keep doing your work. And right now there's this moment where there's all this like press about women in Hollywood, and you know, maybe some of this will affect it. But I think it is definitely a real thing in terms of content, also in terms of like how people, like male writers, how they feel about their female characters versus how they feel about their male characters. I definitely think it's a real thing, but I don't know what you really do about it other than to just like do your thing and I don't know.
You know, this might not be directly, obviously I can't answer what it's like to be a female director. but what I can say is that I'm working on a documentary now about sexual violence actually at a university. And, you know, I pitched the network, which is, you know, great. The executives there are very enlightened, great, open-minded people. And the way I pitched the story was that it was going to be from her point of view, the victim. And what I found, and, you know, along the way as she speaks, she's an advocate for women's rights. And as I was filming, I realized that my audience is going to be 90% male, because it's a male network, male-driven network. The demo's male, and I'm like, you know, our guy's going to start turning off the channel, you know, or turning the channel, because this, you know, female victim story, and people unfortunately say, oh, I've heard that before. This isn't really, you know, what they want to see when they tune in to, you know, an ESPN type of network. So what I realized was that I want to reach as many people as possible, because this is such an important topic. And if I want to reach as many people as possible, I have to figure out a way to present the film in a way that's going to grab everybody, not just, you know, one demo and one, not just another. So actually what I found, and this was just from filming, is I actually found the perpetrator. And I've filmed with him now. And he takes us into the story, and then we hear her story, as opposed to just starting with her story, you know, with the risk of losing viewers right from the beginning. It'll be on in October of 2016, so tune in. We get, the more viewers, the better it is. It allows us to make more films.
I guess just one more thing I'd say is that this film that I'm currently working on, the female characters are kind of unusually well balanced. It's kind of like two husband-wife teams, and the women are kind of equal characters, and the director is like a great, you know, not sexist man. And he's gotten a lot of pushback from the studios of like, not explicit, but kind of like trying to take out jokes that are more, you know, there's some like period jokes in it and stuff like that, that they're just like, I don't think that's funny. You know, that's sort of like the line. It's like, I don't think that's funny, not, you know, that's inappropriate or like whatever. But I think that there is a huge like appetite for films that are more specifically like about women, and that I have found something with my own writing, so, like an instinct to kind of like write male characters because that's what you see all the time. And I feel like there's this moment now where like for instance, like Welcome to Me. I don't know if anyone saw that movie. I love that movie that Kristen Wiig was the star of. And I feel like there is this little bubble that's happening of movies that seem like are kind of trashing the notion of, you know, that it doesn't have to, the men aren't, they're more specifically female point of view. And it's something that I was interested to see in myself when I was writing, having that my instinct was to write male characters because it's what I see. And I've had to kind of try to be like, that's really stupid. You know, I shouldn't be doing this too, just because it's what everyone else does.
I don't know, Frank, if you would agree with me, but I have a feeling that TV is a great place for.
Well, right now, it's just starting right now because it's like whatever this sort of like peak of television or its arrival, like the site, whatever golden age of the many golden ages, the last decade or more has been essentially shows about middle-aged white guys in midlife crisis, like bad dad shows, you know, like from Sopranos to Mad Men to, you know, a whole bunch of them. And I think people are kind of tired of that character, so there's a little bit of an opening at the moment. And I know that even the Guild, the Writers Guild, has it specifically in mind, but there's like an opening for other stories. It's female or others. It's just like a moment where it's like, I'm just tired of guys, you know, I'm a little bit tired of Don Draper. Like, he was great, but it's like, all right, we had a decade of that kind of guy. So like right now, there's a real moment, it's like you can feel it happening. There's like an emerging, there's a moment for different stories on television at the moment. You know, you're starting to see them creep in.
Final question. Do you guys have any personal anecdotes that you think speak to your larger film industry experience?
I've been having a lot of anecdotes with agents lately. It's not really an anecdote, but there was this agent that I met, and he was really like, I'm interested in your work, blah, 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 blah. Like, come, let's have lunch, let's talk, let's do this. And I'm like, great. Big agent. I'm like, oh, awesome. And I went and we talked and blah, blah. And it was great. He was like, oh, yes, and we're going to do all these things. We're going to do all these other things. I'm going to introduce you to all these people. I was like, this is amazing. It's great. Never called me again. Never called. He was the one who invited me for lunch. And he was the one telling me all I barely opened my mouth. Literally, and then never ever called me again. And I emailed him and I was like, hey, remember we had this lunch? And he never answered. So I still don't know what, like, and now a lot of people are telling me, oh no, it's a thing that they do, like agents do that. And I'm like, why would they do that? That doesn't make any sense to me. But yeah, this is the latest thing that's happened to me. So agents, don't answer like the thing. Yeah.
The industry, I find it really gossipy. It's a little really gossipy, and like, it's a little bit like the phone game. Like, you could say, like, oh no, this is just strictly between you and I, and then literally 2 weeks later, you're at a dinner and someone's saying this is strictly between you and I. But, and you know that like 20 people came back around and told you what you told someone 2 weeks before. I mean, it's kind of like, they just, it's a really gossipy business.
It's so true. It's like amazingly indiscreet. Like, yes. In every situation I've been in, I found that. It's like, it's like the door is wide open. This person's like, oh, well, that guy, oh, he's such an idiot. And like, da-da-da-da-da. It's, I don't know what to say about it, but it's been consistently true in my experience also.
I just would say, there's not that many people that actually really want to help you out there, in the industry, because everybody else is, trying to do it for themselves. It's a competitive industry. You got to go out there and get it yourself, and as much as you can, have meet great people along the way, there's much fewer people that are actually, that really care and want to help you than people that, are jealous or envious of what you're doing, don't really want you to succeed, and are not going to really, help you. So be cautious on who you really bring into your circle. Look for people like you'd look for a good friend, And there are great people out there, and I can name a bunch, but really just, be diligent about who you bring into your inner circle, with things that really matter and that things that are important and that you don't want getting out there.
And to that also, I feel like there's a lot of like envy and competitiveness and cattiness and bad instincts kind of that go on. And you should just like try not to fall victim to that. I think it's really easy to be like, oh, like that person, blah, 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 blah. But the truth is, it's like a lot, very frequently the people who are like succeeding are, working really, really hard, and they have every right to be where they are. And it's energy a lot better spent like working on your own thing than stewing over the success of others, which is easy to do.
But I told you, so Lorenzo Semple, who's a great screenwriter, he was always like, the thing about all this, like, and this is about executives and the agents, he's like, the thing that they all know is that there's 6,000 of them, but there's 30,000 of them that know how to do the job. Just always know there's 5 people waiting for that gig that they have. So, okay, great.
Great, thank you guys. Thank you.